I thank you very much for this opportunity to participate. I thought I would start with introducing myself. And this is how most people would see me. If you Google me, you probably discover my LinkedIn profile. There are many things there, press releases and a lot about me. One thing that probably would immediately jump out is that I'm not known as an aging scientist. My original training was in artificial intelligence and machine learning. I got a PhD in that field. I then moved to biology, to the Department of Systems Biology at Harvard. And mostly my work is about embryology, embryonic development and proteomics, transcriptomics, single cell transcriptomics in embryos. Though working on aging was my lifelong dream, and relatively recently, I would say about 4 years ago, I realized that machine learning, this training as being trained as engineer and embryology serendipitously set me up to work in aging. And so with that, I moved into aging. I'm proud to have people you definitely know if you're interested in aging. George and David Sinclair as my colleagues here at Harvard. In their words, two things that I work on where I contribute and which I will briefly cover today are a germline reset and scalable pharmacology platform. So those are two very loosely related subjects. One has to do with answering a question, where do we look for secret of rejuvenation? Another has to do with if me or somebody else has found therapy, how do you check it in a robust and a scalable way? But first, as a way of a quick introduction, I wanted to come back to my own interview with Lifespan Iowa, and I hope you excuse me for quoting myself. Leon Peshkin says here, I would like to offer a caricature of the current popular sensationalist view in the field. Right. So the caricature is, we are a chosen generation, singularity is near, rejuvenation therapy is almost here, not a single therapy, several a la carte, stem cells, young blood, senolytics, rapalogs, NAD, and so on and so forth. Companies backed up by luminaries from business and science are already sorting out remaining details, helped by formidable force of artificial intelligence known as deep learning. There are journal articles, editorials, like this one I'm showing here, MIT Technology Review, saying the old age is over, we're very close. This is perhaps where I differ with many of my colleagues in the field. I think that this sensationalism is harmful. That this false sense of accomplishment is really counterproductive. And it is way too early to worry about marketing, patenting, and profits. Not because I'm a flaming communist. I think capitalism is great. Commercial activities is wonderful. But at this early stage, it leads to hiding the approaches, hiding the data. And that's why we all lose. This is time to widely share what we know to create reliable, high quality data and look at it in the most open and collaborative way. So I will illustrate further. This is from the recent article, The Business of Anti-Aging. So this is just a short list of companies in the field of senolytics. Companies obviously working on the approach we just heard about. There are articles in the field. This is a relatively recent article from a reputed lab about approaches to roll back time. So I want to be very clear. I'm not at all saying that there is some kind of disingenuous science here. On the contrary, my colleagues, I think, are doing great science. There are a lot of promising and exciting approaches. And if there is any misrepresentation, it is misrepresentation by wishful thinking in the audience and by journalists who are very quick in jumping from scientific literature to conclusions that such and such paper has a recipe that we could apply tomorrow. So the problem is generally not new. This is just a quick collection of research about research, which shows that most published research are false. Not because people are trying to lie, because reproducible research in biology is extremely difficult. So this is an example from our field of rejuvenation. National Institute of Aging and NIH set up the so-called intervention testing program. So it's a wonderful program where you can propose intervention, test it in mice, see how long they live. They tried about 50 different interventions, compounds. To date, I would say we have learned very little, unfortunately. So we are in this, you know, maybe rapamycin is the only compound that in both male and female mice affords some life extension. There's also a new program set up by National Institute of Aging in interventions testing in nematodes, which I think is good to have for some reasons. Yet what we can learn in nematodes is very approximately transferable to humans for many reasons, which I will actually mention below. So let's look closer at one example. This is a study that unfortunately is still unpublished from a friend and colleague of this university that many people in the field have heard about in his presentations and talks. So it's a wonderful idea for many reasons. My colleagues took 1,000 different compounds, drugs, which are soluble in water and fed mice lifelong. So this is a study of 1,000 drugs at one single dose, lifelong. So they had to use 20,000 mice, 15 mice per drug, 200 calorie restriction and 300 controls. I might be a little off, but this is roughly a ballpark. So such study took 4 years, and I don't know exact numbers, but this is $15 to $20 million. So what are these people trying to do? Why do I say that's a great idea? It's not like we think that we take 1,000 drugs and then one of the drugs miraculously is the drug we're looking for. Not at all. The idea here is that we find a few drugs which were developed for a different purpose, which may be a little bit, tiny 1-2% extend life. And then because we know what is the mode of action of these drugs, we could bootstrap. We could generalize and look for better drugs with this principle. So this is how we generally measure the results with such study. We take 100% of population, put those on drugs, and then compare what happens, how rapidly these animals die under different conditions. Notice that as expensive as those studies are, the only thing we learn for all this investment is how long the animal live. We do not learn how active are the animal, how well they reproduce, what is their general health, and so on and so forth. So this is just a review I recommend. Why drugs that work in mice don't work in humans. This is by Sarah Constantine. It's excellent, but this is a whole other story. So let's also think at this database. Drug Age is a database many of you are familiar with. On one hand, there are great news. We know that there are many bioactive compounds which extend life in various species a little bit. This suggests an opportunity. However, if you take a close look at this data, it is ridden with problems. Why? You find that the same compound extends life in one species, but not the others. Sometimes experiments in the same species are telling us very different thing, and so on and so forth. So why am I complaining? And what do I propose? This is just to represent kind of my ideal world. It's the so-called ecosphere. It's a toy you can buy in many stores, which is completely closed off environment where you get shrimp living for months, sometimes even years, which is completely controlled environment. So I wish we had a system where in this completely controlled environment, we could add a drug. Otherwise, we would have thousands or tens of thousands of ideal ecospheres like that, where we would observe not just how long the animal live, but also cognitive and cardiac and immune and reproductive function and compare in order to see what drug does with certainty. So this is just a quick table to compare different species. And I could tell you that for many different reasons, none of the species currently used are suitable for such tasks. There are many reasons why we cannot do this, obviously, in human. It's super expensive and not scalable in mice. Even so-called short-lived killifish is not such a short life and also very expensive to try drugs. Nematodes, if you look at any paper in nematodes, the concentration of drugs is completely unphysiological and super high. So the drug is hardly soluble at that concentration, not to mention that nematodes are essentially crawling guts made of 1,000 cells with no organs of interest. So we have been developing a new species, which we think is answer to this issue over here on the right, which are Daphnia. And next I'm going to play a short video. Two-minute video which introduces Daphnia. Daphnia is a tiny 1/10 of an inch freshwater crustacean with many unique features for studying aging processes. It has 1 month life expectancy and parthenogenically produces unlimited quantities of genetically identical offspring. To us, the key feature is its exquisite permeability to drugs. It enables direct pharmacological study in small volumes of water. Chiefly used in toxicology studies, Daphnia has been well studied for pharmacology. For example, a normal rhythm of 200 heartbeats per minute responds to human cardiac drugs by changes in rate and arrhythmias remarkably like human heart. The heart pumps blood with clearly visible immune cells. In fact, it was in Daphnia over a century ago that the immune system was discovered and later shown to be similar to human. The moving eye of Daphnia is connected by optic nerves to the brain, which you can also see in this remarkably transparent animal. Genetics of Daphnia is a reality. The complete genome is available and CRISPR editing has already been accomplished. The readily observable physiology of Daphnia's heart, liver, brain, muscle, and immune system makes it a great object to uncover the mechanisms of aging. Our main goal is to use Daphnia in conjunction with such tools as mass spectrometry, single-cell transcriptomics, and panels of drugs to efficiently characterize the aging processes, and in particular, the effects of anti-aging and rejuvenating interventions. All right. So I'm often asked about the immune system. Of course, I meant here innate immune system, not adaptive. This video is available if you want to go back to it. This is what we're actually trying to do. We're developing a scalable system where in one tank, as I was saying, you can have hundreds of animals under the influence of one drug, one dose, and then so scale it up, video record what's happening. Here is an example of many of the tanks sitting in the incubator under temperature controlled conditions with controlled diet and a standardized recording setup. So then you collect videos which look like this. So you see Daphnias dancing, then we turn the light on, they rapidly run towards the light, you turn the light off, they rapidly come back. So that's very nice because we could characterize reaction time, some cognitive function, and so on and so forth. There's room for application of automated imaging and artificial intelligence, which we were already attempting to do. One simplest application is how many animals are there. So in order to make the slice span curves, you need to automatically count because you have thousands of those tanks on camera, all going for about 1 month. And so let me not dwell on this. We develop machine learning approaches to count this Daphnia, to score how long they live. This is just a mortality risk, which shows that 1 day of Daphnia is roughly 1 year of human life, that risks change in a very similar way. So now the idea is, okay, we can characterize drugs in Daphnia. What do we do? So this is just a schematic to show that what we do is we dump thousands of compounds, some of which are characterized and some are not, and we co-embed in the space of features, reactions, and effects, known and unknown drugs. And now we can reason about drugs in this way. We tried several pilot studies. The first one we tried was alcohol. It's kind of funny to see drunken Daphnia, but look at this result, it's a very recent result, which I find pretty remarkable. So this is young and old Daphnia reacting to light. Or rather, you see that young Daphnia reacts to light. They detect light and they rush towards it for whatever reason has evolved. The old Daphnia, let me play this again, completely ignores the light. So there we go. It's a scalable assay which allows us to profile reactions in this animal. So what can you do with this? We measure, as I was saying, many features. Now, when you take a tank of animals where, remember, every animal in this tank is a sibling. They're all the same age. There are hundreds of them. You collect behavioral features and you stick this into machine learning model, which guesses how old it is. So imagine looking at the person and asking, well, how does this person walk? What's the gait? How rapidly they react? Having an annual physical exam and then saying, oh, you look, you know, we know you're 60, but you look 30. So this is a kind of models, phenotypical clocks that we develop. And then we build a model which predicts the age pretty robustly, decline of various functions with age. So it's tempting then to ask, fine, if I now dump a drug, does this drug make you younger? Not does it make you live longer, but does it make you live younger, right? Does it make you generally healthier? And so the key word on this slide is pilot. We do not have a drug for you to take tomorrow. We're developing a platform. We were playing with metformin. And in this very small trial, it looks like some of the features we mentioned make Daphnia look younger here. So this is a general idea about approach, scalable approach of testing myriads of proposed interventions, which are diets and drugs and various other changes in a scalable way. So now let me get to the other subject, which is, okay, fine, this is how we test the answer, maybe. This is how we compare drugs, but where do we look for our rejuvenation secret? And so here I want to give you my argument that the secret of rejuvenation has already been discovered. Right. So this is generally how we find our greatest accomplishments in biomedicine. If you think about painkillers, antibiotics, and vaccines, which in my view are three greatest accomplishments, we did not engineer any of those. Nature did. We at some point observed, and without really a deep understanding of how it works, transferred into a new context. I hope this makes sense. I think the same exact thing is going to happen with rejuvenation. It already is happening in nature. In fact, Yuri has done my work for me. He already very eloquently explained what happens. I just want to repeat, in the cycle of life, we seem to take old cells and make new life. So how does that happen? When does it happen? Can we find the secret and apply the secret to older tissues? So there is an idea that maybe there is no secret at all. Maybe there somehow germline remains young. Maybe there is no secret at all because, yes, there is damage in old oocytes, but this damage is not fixed, it's just diluted, so it just doesn't matter. But I show here an example from my own research, where in frogs, we showed that, in fact, this kind of damaged protein would damage next generation. So if there was no program of rejuvenation in the embryo, each next generation would have to live shorter and shorter life. I show it because I actually track proteins, and I see that very early these proteins are incorporated and used. So damaged proteins would be a problem. If this slide looks familiar, it's because I actually borrowed it from Yuri. Thank you, Yuri. So we saw examples where here in worms, this so-called rejuvenation has been observed. Another powerful clue is, again, thank you, Yuri, comes from the fact that cloned animals live as long as their quote-unquote parents. So it was first shown in frog, and the cloning was developed in frog. And John Gordon is also a colleague. He would know who I am if you ask. I turn to him for advice because what I do in the lab, I don't just work with Daphnia, I also work with the same frog species where we observe embryonic development closely. So my work with, in this area roughly looks like this. This is a award-winning video, which I'm not going to play. I suggest you go and see it, called Becoming. It's an amazing video showing in every detail from conception to pretty advanced stages development of a newt. So I look at the first few days from oocyte, essentially ovulation, maturation, fertilization, at this processes of development, using mass spectrometry. And I try to figure out when this rejuvenation happens, which molecules are involved. So why is it so hard? Why not everybody does this? First of all, a toy like this, the one that I'm showing on the right, a single sort of microwave-sized toy has a shelf price of over $1 million. So having the best instrument is tricky. Then you don't see much. There is a trade-off between how you run this instrument, how far you can sort of look into the galaxy, how many molecules you see. So to remind you how many molecules are there, I like to compare genome to a cookbook. Genome often compared to just a book, but here I compare it to a cookbook. It's very important. A cookbook is a bunch of recipes, and protein is a product, is not just text. So in our genome, we have about 20,000 genes. Those genes go through transcription to RNA. In turn, those are transcribed translated into proteins. So how many proteins do we get? About 100,000. Then proteins are further edited and modified. We get about, much over a million of actual molecules working in each instance. How many can we observe today? Not very many. Essentially, if you just have one of those instruments running entirely for yourself, you could probably get about 10,000 of those molecules and track about 10,000 in experiment that takes many months. So if you would like to develop methods to track different 10,000s, that's very hard. You essentially see what you see. All of this, I'm sorry, this is hand wavy, this is very unspecific, but it's hard to explain to a non-specialist why this takes both knowledge of computer science, machine learning, engineering, in order to track these processes at the resolution, which would show us what's going on. So, with this, I want to maybe leave a little bit more time for questions, come to my last slide. But I want to say again that my work is in methods development, in embryology. Aging essentially has been a hobby for me so far. And if I need to talk about my business model, I want to offer you another caricature. My business model is no business model. I don't think this is time to be investing. This is time to support research so that data comes back to the public immediately, openly shared, that benchmarks are created, the technology immediately shared with everybody else around the world who can use it. And that, yes, investing is fine, but the most precious return that we can hope for are extra years of healthy life. And with this, I will stop for questions.